Believe and Be Saved, or Around the Wicket Gate, Updated Edition. I am the door. Whosoever enters in by me shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. John 10:9. Written by Charles H. Spurgeon, narrated by Saethon Williams. Preface. Millions of men are in the outlying regions, far from God and peace. For these we pray, and to these we give warning. But now we need to address a smaller company who are not far from the kingdom, but have come right up to the wicket gate, which stands at the head of the way of life. One would think that they would hurry to enter, for a free and open invitation is placed over the entrance, and the porter waits to welcome them. This is the only way to eternal life. He that is most burdened seems the most likely to pass through and begin the heavenward journey. But what ails the other men? This is what I want to find out. Poor fellows, they have come a long way already to get where they are, and the king's highway, which they seek, is right before them. Why don't they take the pilgrim road at once? Alas, they have a great many reasons. And foolish as those reasons are, it takes a very wise man to answer them all. I cannot pretend to do so. Only the Lord himself can remove the folly which is bound up in their hearts, and lead them to take the great decisive step. Yet the Lord uses various methods and approaches. I have prepared this little book in the earnest hope that he may use it to lead seekers to an immediate, simple trust in the Lord Jesus. He who does not take the step of faith and enter upon the road to heaven will perish. It will be an awful thing to die close to, but yet outside, the gate of life. Almost saved, but altogether lost. This is the most terrible of positions. A man just outside Noah's Ark would have drowned. A murderer close to the wall of a city of refuge, but outside of it, would be slain. And the man who is within a yard of Christ, but has not trusted him, will be lost. Therefore, I am in terrible earnest to get my hesitating friends over the threshold. Come in, is my pressing plea. Why dost thou stand outside, is my solemn inquiry. Genesis 24:31. May the Holy Spirit render my pleadings effective with many who read or listen to these pages. May he cause his own almighty power to create faith in the soul at once. My listener, if God blesses this book to you, do the writer this favor. Either lend your own copy to someone who is lingering at the gate, or buy another and give it away, for his great desire is that this little volume should be of service to many thousands of souls. To God this book is commended, for without his grace nothing will come of all that is written. C. H. Spurgeon. Chapter 1. Wake Up. Many people have no concern about eternal things. They care more about their cats and dogs than about their souls. It is a great act of kindness to be made to think about ourselves and our standing with God and the eternal world. This is often a sign that salvation is coming to us. By nature, we do not like the anxiety that spiritual concern causes us, and like sluggards, we try to ignore it and sleep again. This is great foolishness, for it is to our peril that we procrastinate when death is so near and judgment is so sure. If the Lord has given us eternal life, he will not let us return to our slumber. Scripture: Of those whom thou gavest me, I have lost none. John 18:9. If we are sensible, we shall pray that our anxiety about our souls may never end until we are really and truly saved. Let us say from our hearts, He that suffered in my stead shall my physician be. I will not be comforted till Jesus comfort me. It would be an awful thing to go dreaming down to hell and then lift our eyes upon a great gulf fixed between us and heaven. It will be equally terrible to be aroused to escape from the wrath to come, but then to shake off the warning influence and go back to our apathy. I notice that those who overcome their convictions and continue in their sins are not as easily moved the next time. Every awakening which is thrown away leaves the soul drowsier than before, and less likely to be stirred again to holy feeling. Therefore, our heart should be greatly troubled at the thought of getting rid of its trouble in any other than the right way. One who had the gout was cured by a quack medicine, but it drove the disease within, and the patient died. To be cured of distress of mind by a false hope would be a terrible treatment. The remedy would be worse than the disease. Better by far if our tenderness of conscience should cause us long years of anguish than if we should lose it and perish in the hardness of our hearts. Yet awakening and awareness of our need is not a thing to rest in or to desire to have prolonged month after month. If I wake up in a fright and find my house on fire, I do not sit at the edge of the bed and say to myself, "I hope I am truly awakened." Indeed, I am deeply grateful that I am not still asleep. No, I want to escape from threatened death, so I hurry to the door or to the window to get out and not perish where I am. It would be a questionable favor to be aroused, but not escape from the danger. Remember, awakening is not salvation. A man may know that he is lost, but he may never be saved. He may be made thoughtful, but he may die in his sins. If you discover that you are bankrupt, the consideration of your debts will not pay them. A man may examine his wounds all year long, and they will not be closer to being healed because he feels the pain and notes their extent. One trick of the devil is to tempt a man to be satisfied with a sense of sin. Another trick is to insinuate that the sinner might not be able to trust Christ unless he can bring a certain measure of despair to add to the Saviour's finished work. Our awakenings, our recognition of our sins, are not to help the Saviour, but to help us to the Saviour. To imagine that my feeling of sin is to assist in the removal of the sin is absurd. It is as though I said that water could not cleanse my face unless I had looked longer in the mirror and had counted the smudges on my forehead. A sense of need of salvation by grace is a very healthy sign, but one needs wisdom to use it right and not to make an idol of it. Some seem to have fallen in love with their doubts and fears and distresses. You cannot get them away from their terrors. They seem wedded to them. It is said that the worst trouble with horses, when their stables are on fire, is that you cannot get them to come out of their stalls. If they would just follow your lead, they might escape the flames, but they seem to be paralyzed with fear. So the fear of the fire prevents their escaping the fire. Listener, will your fear of the wrath to come prevent your escaping from it? We hope not. One person who had been in prison a long time was not willing to come out. The door was open, but he pleaded, even with tears, to be allowed to stay where he was. Fond of prison, wedded to the iron bolts and the prison fare. Surely the prisoner must have been a little touched in the head. Are you willing to remain simply awakened and nothing more? Aren't you eager to be forgiven at once? If you would wait in anguish and dread, surely you too must be a little out of your mind. If peace is to be had, have it at once. Why wait in the darkness of the pit where your feet sink in the miry clay? There is light to be had, marvelous and heavenly light. Why lie in the gloom and die in anguish? You do not know how near salvation is to you. If you did, you would surely stretch out your hand and take it, for there it is, and it is yours for the taking. Scripture: For now is our saving health nearer than when we believed. The night is past, and the day is come. Let us, therefore, cast off the works of darkness, and let us clothe ourselves with the weapons of light. Romans 13:11-12. Do not think that feelings of despair will fit you for mercy. When the pilgrim was on his way to the wicket gate, he tumbled into the slough of despond. Footnote: The Wicket Gate in The Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan represents the narrow road to salvation as described in Matthew 7:13-14. The Slough of Despond is the deep bog that Christian sinks into under the weight of sin and guilt. Do you think that when the foul mire of that slough stuck to his garments, it was told to him that it would get him an easier admission to the way? It is not so. The pilgrim did not think so by any means. Neither should you. It is not what you feel that will save you, but what Jesus felt. Scripture: And when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad, as sheep having no shepherd. Matthew 9:36. Even if there were some healing value in feelings, the feelings would have to be good ones. The feeling which makes us doubt the power of Christ to save and prevents us from finding salvation in him is by no means a good one, but a cruel wrong to the love of Jesus. Our friend has come to see us and has travelled through our crowded London by rail or tram or omnibus. All of a sudden he turns pale. We ask him what is the matter, and he answers, "I've lost my pocketbook, and it contained all the money I have in the world." He recites the amount to a penny and describes the checks, bills, notes, and coins. We tell him that it must be a great consolation to him to be so precise about the extent of his loss. He does not seem to see the worth of our consolation. We assure him that he ought to be grateful that he has so clear a sense of his loss, for many people might have lost their pocketbooks and been quite unable to know the extent of their losses. Our friend is not, however, cheered in the least. "No," says he, "to know my loss does not help me to recover it. Tell me where I can find my property, and you have done me real service, but merely to recognize my loss is no comfort whatever." Even so, to believe that you have sinned and that your soul is subject to the justice of God is a very proper thing. But that knowledge will not save. Salvation is not by our knowing our own ruin, but by fully grasping the deliverance provided in Christ Jesus. A person who refuses to look to the Lord Jesus, but persists in dwelling on his sin and ruin, reminds us of a boy who dropped a shilling down an open grate of a London sewer and lingered there for hours, finding comfort in saying, "It rolled in right there, just between those two iron bars I saw it go down." Poor soul! He might remember the details of his loss for a long time before he would get a single penny back into his pocket to buy himself a piece of bread.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.